Hello everybody, welcome back here at Gaming Boulevard. Thank you for tuning in on our YouTube channel. So, we're with a familiar face for those who don't know you. Can you give a quick introduction?
Sure, I'm Brjann Sigurgeirsson of Image and Form Games in Gothenburg, Sweden. It's really good to be developing games in Sweden because it rains all the time. So, we have a lot of time on our hands to make the best games on the planet.
Alright, cool. So SteamWorld Dig 2 is the new one that is coming. It's also coming on Nintendo Switch. Last year we spoke and then there was nothing known about the Switch. We called it the NX. I asked you how is it. You couldn't tell. When you first learned about a Nintendo Switch, what was your first reaction to the console?
Well, it's a little bit of a longer story because we went from... we had a meeting at GDC in San Francisco last year, in March 2016. And right after that, they asked a lot of questions about what our next game was and when it was coming and so on. And apparently all the answers were correct. So they called us down very, very, very soon after that, down to Frankfurt. So me and our chief technical officer, Ole Håkansson, we went down to be disclosed. And so they told us what it was, but they didn't show any pictures of like the final, what it was supposed to look like, which was very good because later on, I mean, the NX leaked a little bit in the press and there were tons of like different images of this is what it looks like, etc. And I was just so relieved that we had no idea what it looked like. But we got the dev kit and we played around with it and just tried to get something up and running very quickly. And we had set aside some, I think it was like 12 business days or something to get a working build, like something that was properly running on the NX. And we were done in less than 2 days. So we emailed Nintendo and said, are we doing something wrong? Because it's working, what are we missing? It looks like it's running. And they said, okay, let's have a look at the, no, it's up and running, you're good. So those are my first impressions of the NX, so to speak. It was all the secrecy around it, and also that it was easy to work with, even when it wasn't finished, right? I'm really surprised at what Nintendo has done here, and I'm surprised, and I'm very, very happy at the same time, because it means we have sort of been, we have had very good relations with Nintendo for a long time, and so it means that we have been backing the right horse, so to speak. Yeah,
definitely. So SteamWorld Dig 2, let's talk a bit more about that one. What's the major difference compared to the first one? Because we know the games you've made, so you have SteamWorld Dig, you have SteamWorld Heist, which was a major difference in gameplay. Now you're doing a more direct sequel to one of the concepts. How is that?
Well, the main difference is that there's a 2 at the end. I don't know if you've seen it. Now, the thing is that when we made SteamWorld Dig, it's 4 years ago, but it's also an eternity ago for us. 4 years ago, nobody knew about Image and Form. We were completely unknown, and Nintendo sort of lifted us up. Really, it sounds like I'm really fanboying here, but they made us in a sense at that time. We were nobody, and they did something big with SteamWorld Dig and sort of got it out to the public, and we're still like really grateful for that. So but at the time, when we finished up SteamWorld Dig, we actually ran out of money. We had to wrap it up very quickly at the end, and there were so many things in SteamWorld Dig that we had to cut out. So when we read all the reviews, we were getting wonderful reviews all over the board, but in the office we all the time knew that there were things that didn't make it into the game, like both in terms of game mechanics but also the story and so on. So we said that once we were done with it, we had like a beer after sending it off, and we said that if we ever get money enough, we have to make SteamWorld Dig 2, because there's so much more to sort of explore in that. And SteamWorld Dig 2, like, if you're talking about differences, then there are some major differences in these games. Obviously, there are similarities too. Otherwise, we wouldn't have called it SteamWorld Dig 2, right? But it's a standalone sequel. You don't have to have played the first one to play this one. And one thing is that it's just very much bigger. I mean, SteamWorld Dig was, I think you could finish that game in, say, 4 or 5 hours or so. So my first playthrough, and I already knew the game quite well, was at somewhere just over 8 hours in SteamWorld Dig 2, and then I was cheating a little bit too. So it's a longer game, but then when you are done, when you've played through the game, you're actually not done. So there is some extra stuff that I'm not going to talk about it here, but I like it the way it's set up, because it caters to people like me who want to explore things. Like it's really exploration based. So SteamWorld Dig was sort of mission based throughout the game. It's like you do this, then you do this, then you do this, and then you do this. This is, I mean, it's not open world like Witcher 3 or something like that, but there's a few hours of gameplay indifference there, I think. but yeah, it's really exploration based, and it's thoroughly enjoyable that way. So that's one difference. The other big difference is that when we made SteamWorld Dig, when we started making it, I think we were 5 or 6 people in the office. Now we are 22, going on, yeah. So we're growing, and it also means that now we have dedicated level designers, so we can actually, the entire game is handmade now. So there are thousands of hours, like placing out every tile, just making sure that, like, it's a really designed and optimal experience. Also, it's kind of it's a more fair experience too. Like we still have this self-destruct option in the game. If you really get stuck and if you dig yourself into a hole and you're like, oh, okay, that's it, then you can self-destruct and sort of be rebuilt. But in Dig, the original Dig, you really had to use this self-destruct feature, because we were programming everything in the game. It was procedural, so we couldn't really sort of foresee everything that was going to happen. This time, it's a lot safer for kids. Let's put it that way. So you won't be using that as much. Like it's really designed for there to be a solution the whole time. Yeah, I have lots more to say, but I was worried about your arm there. It's like
okay, cool. If you could name like one thing you like the most about a game, what would it be?
The thing that I like the most is a subtle thing. There are so many things that I like about it. One thing, I'm just going to mention that really briefly and then go on to the my favorite thing. But one thing is that one challenge when you make a sequel to something is like, how are you going to make it different? I mean, how are you going to ensure that it's just not more of the same, right? So in SteamWorld Dig, you dig for stuff and then you bring it up to the surface, you sell it, you upgrade your things, and you get new tools and new abilities and so on. Now, one of the big challenges was, how are we going to, in a digging game, make that completely new? How are we going to give the player just radically new tools and toys and ways to maximize those and upgrade? And that's been a challenge, and I think we have met it it's beautifully made. There's that part, the Metroidvania part of the game, there's just so much more to it now. Like everything can be upgraded in so many different ways, and you can sort of, it's an economy that is sort of a reversible too. Like you sort of spend money on, I'm going to spend currency on this right now, I'm going to upgrade this tool this way, and then you can sort of undo it later. It's like, yeah, I'm going to move some of that. It's like you go up to the surface, sort of unload your backpack and fill it with other stuff the next time you go down. So that's really cool. Sorry, that was the short one. Yeah. Now the my major happiness with the game is sort of on a philosophical level, and that sounds really deep, bear with me, right? It's like the game starts out with one objective, one very clear objective for Dorothy, the main character. And she is, I mean, the game doesn't joke about it. It's like the very first thing that happens in the game is like, okay, this is what this game is going to be about. And it's sort of, to her, that is sort of the main thing throughout the game. But like, after a while in the game, it sort of changes, right? It's like it subtly, like piece by piece, slowly by, like little by little, almost like watching a kid grow or something. Yeah. Like you can't see, or watching grass grow or something. Wow, that's really boring. But but it's sort of the focus sort of shifts, and you get to a point in the game where you sort of look at it, it's like, what am I doing? It's like, what is, how did this? Like, it's sort of like you've been walking forever just thinking to yourself, and then you look up and look around, and it's like, how did I end up here? That is sort of like a goosebumpy feeling that I really enjoy about the game. Yeah, and then there are like dozens of other things that I love about the game, but like there are other small things, like the soundtrack is, because music in games is so important, and this is definitely a game that I really hope as many people as possible can play with good headphones, you know, because the soundtrack is just wonderful. It's really wonderful, and we have some news coming about that, who we are collaborating with regarding the music, but we're sort of we're keeping it under tabs for a little while longer.
Right, exciting. I think a lot of gamers are looking forward to it. Will there be, so it's an indie game, so it will be downloadable. Will there be, like, I don't know, I'm just guessing what Nintendo fans like. Will there be some kind of collector's edition in stores or a regular edition? Perhaps even an amiibo? We spoke about that last year. Yeah. I'm still the amiibo boy, so the viewers of the channel know it. We have a lot of amiibo love. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, well, If you're an amiibo fan, please write it in the comment below. It's not for me, obviously. I don't make amiibos, but we are very curious to know if there is still like an interest for amiibos. And the reason is, amiibo is not a new thing now. But at the same time, like, Nintendo gamers are collectors. Yeah. They love their stuff, right? And I was thinking, I said, yeah, we're going to sell it digitally. That's how it's going to be from the beginning. But I'm surprised still at, like, there are too few Switch games out in the stores. Yeah. So I'm just thinking, okay, let's get a move on and make a physical version of this. I need to talk to Nintendo some more, obviously, but I'm not sure if they want to see sort of collections or old stuff on the Switch yet.
Yeah.
So, earlier, before, we just felt like it was just such a big undertaking to do these physical games, so we didn't think too much about it. But it isn't that hard, you know. It's like, it's, you take the game, you call up someone who can sell it for you, and that's it. So we are. I think I can promise that there will be a physical version of SteamWorld Dig 2 coming out. And hopefully we can make it standalone, just like a single thing. And then we'll steal everyone's money and make a collection later on, right? But it's not that hard. It's also because I'm surprised that there are so few physical games.
Exactly.
Because the Switch is a Nintendo product, and the Nintendo players are Nintendo players, right? Then about amiibos. Yeah. So we are, I don't think there is like an entire week in the office where we don't have a semi-serious discussion about amiibo.
Okay.
One of the things that your viewers might not know is that if you're going to make an amiibo, you need to at least, you have to manufacture at least 100,000 or something like that. And I don't think you need to sell all of those to break even. That would be crazy, but it's a risk, yeah. And we would... it'd be interesting to see what character people would like the most and so on. But then again, I mean, so many of us in the office are Nintendo fanboys, right? I'm probably like the most neutral one. Like, there are people with tattoos and stuff. So If there's anything we'd like to make in sort of in terms of merchandise, it's definitely amiibos. So the discussion is not over, but we want to hear what people think.
Yeah. Write it down in the comments. You know what to do. The last question. So SteamWorld Dig 2 is almost complete, I'm guessing. So what are your dreams, the future plans? What are the things that you're thinking from? Man, I want to do this. It will be my dream project.
Well, it's obviously we are in talks with Nintendo now to make the next Zelda. Right. So that's a dream project.
Yeah.
So no, it's well, actually, it would be cool to collaborate with Nintendo on something, because again, yeah, we are sort of Nintendo fan people in the office. But I mean, the dream project is to do what we are doing now, like to be. There's a thing about being independent, which is these days, like independent studios are becoming bigger as well. I think it's time to sort of come up with a new term for it. Like we have small indies, we have like mid-sized indies, we have larger indie studios. Like Nintendo is joking and saying they see themselves as the world's largest independent studio, right? So we are. That's one of my goals, so to speak, that people are not sort of patting us on the head and saying, like, this is a great game for being an indie studio. That's not what we're aiming at. We're aiming to make the best games on the planet, really. And I just want us to get better and better and better, because, I mean, at the end of your career, or say you sort of, at the end, you have to turn around and look back at what you did, and what did you make? Like, did you make match 3 clones your entire, or did you just run after the pack to see, to try to do what was popular at the time? If you're fine with that, then that's great. But I'm not fine with that. I really want to look back and say, yes, I actually did this. I planted some happiness in the lives of quite a few people, and I think there are a few people. I think there are many people who are doing that in the gaming industry, that they're making wonderful games, and if they hadn't made the game, the world would have been poorer. I want to have made a difference at the end. So to answer you, that's, as usual, it's a very long answer, but that's the answer. It's like my pet project is to just get better, that we make better and better games that touch more and more people.
I think you're already succeeding in that goal. A lot of gamers love the franchises, so you're really doing a great job for an indie developer. No, with all honesty, thank you for this interview, and all the best luck in the future for the rest of the project. Maybe you want to say something to the fans to conclude.
I'm just going to say thanks for tuning in and for following these guys, because I think they're actually doing a marvelous job. And the last thing is that SteamWorld Dig 2 is coming very, very, very soon. It's coming very soon. I can't divulge the release date. I know what it is. You don't. Sorry about that. But you will know very, very soon. Cheers.